Welcome to V8 Nation, talking all things motorsport with Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell.
Hello everybody and welcome to V8 Nation, a huge hour ahead of us talking all things motorsport. GrandForSpeedCafe.com will join us to talk what's happening in the world, all across it. Australians doing very well, a very jam-packed Formula One race last week, plenty of news in the V8 world as well, and the two men who are up there all the time, sometimes crashing into each other, sometimes pretending to be nice to each other, is Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell. Boys, how you doing?
Yeah, well, really well. It's been a pretty big week in motorsport, topping off a great guest on last week with Sam Newman. And it's certainly got the at V8 Nation Twitter account going off, and we'll no doubt speak a bit later about a bit of the criticism which I've received, which is very, very interesting.
I like it. Keep it coming in, folks.
Yeah, no problems at all. I believe that Rick Kelly might have been behind that, but we will talk a little bit more about that. Just on the back of Sam Newman last week, there's no truth to the rumour, even though Rick's been a little nervous, because he threw the big question out. He said, what do you feel about controversy? You're the only person I found on Wikipedia with that type of headline. And he's still a little bit nervous, aren't you, Rick, that Sam isn't overly impressed with it and he might be lurking around the next corner.
I was worried. I was like sitting next to him, so I was wanting PD to throw those sorts of questions to him. But no, it was great having him in. His knowledge of cars, I think, outweighs both Paul's and my knowledge put together, which is fantastic. But some of those cars he's got in his garage are very impressive. Love to have a look at them.
That's for sure. Shelby. I couldn't believe the quality of cars. It's certainly quite an astute person to know exactly what he wants from a car perspective. So no, it's good to see someone else sharing the same passion that we have in cars.
Yeah.
And Rico, you were just talking about in the pre-show about the limo. Now, can you explain to everyone the limo that you bought last year?
Well, we try and take a different car to Bathurst every year as part of the Kelly Racing or the Kelly Brothers, I guess, trip to Bathurst. We started off in a Brits Happy Camper many years ago with Nathan Pretty, and that progressed to us doing up a combi, which we never got ready in time for Bathurst. But we had an old HQ or an old Kingswood, actually, with an old Merlin caravan, which we drove up to Bathurst, which is a lot of fun. We took the wrong road and ended up on the dirt tracks for a fair way to Bathurst, believe it or not. And we ended up purchasing an 89 Cadillac limo, which we all piled in, the eight drivers, enduro drivers for the Bathurst event, and headed to the mountain. And it was a lot of fun, but it's taken up a fair bit of space in the garage, and the door sort of shuts halfway along. It doesn't quite fit in the two-car garage. So it's time for her to go, I think. We've had it for nearly 11 months. Before we got it, I come up with a whole heap of reasons why, limos are the next big thing and why you need them, and it just hasn't worked out that way. So I was hoping to take you to dinner once a week and charge you a fortune, but that hasn't come through either, so we're going to have to move it on, I think.
Yeah, no, it's. I remember just before Bathurst, you actually rang me up and said, "I've got the best deal that you should invest in. I need to buy a limo to get up to Bathurst, and I reckon you're the perfect person to own half of it with me."
I'm like, I want to ask you, PD, because I know you'll be honest about this. How many people in V8 supercars would just think, "I've got to buy a limo just to get to Bathurst"? How many people outside of Rick, because he's done it? How many would do it?
Hey, I'm not going to lie to all our listeners at home. I wouldn't think there's too many people out there who would go and do it, but some of the things I've seen Rico do, the world land speed record for a remote control car, attempt of the world land speed record for a remote control car, and that was phenomenal. The quality and effort that he went into this remote control car was unbelievable. It was phenomenal. It went pretty good sideways and upside down.
Talk to us. Tell us what happened.
No, well, I still think that was a great idea. I just didn't execute it very well. I come up with the idea while I was sitting around in Darwin. Oh, she's probably 8 years ago now, I reckon. And
wasn't it New Zealand? Didn't you take some great money off of a local New Zealand car dealer?
Yeah, and I had to give that back. I never actually ran his logo on the car, but it took me 5 years to build and over 1,000 hours. It's powered by two real jet turbines, and it was supposed to do phenomenal speeds, and it just handled, unfortunately, less than good. And I needed to get to 124k an hour, and I could only get to 90 and end up fencing it and smashing it. But halfway through rebuilding it now, having a hand in running the race team certainly stopped me.
The best story of the whole thing, he actually flew down the guy from the Guinness World Records book to actually, authorise, I guess, the speed attempt. And, they've done a few runs and they're trying to get it up quicker and whatnot. And then Rick's had this big crash and the guy sort of pulled out the certificate, which had the record there, put it back in his briefcase, got in his car and drove off.
Yeah.
whereabouts did you attempt the record?
It was at Holden's Proving Ground at Lang Lang. So we used their oval dish and spent the whole day just trying and trying and trying. It's funny, I think PD knew my capability, or engineering capability, because he didn't offer to sponsor the side of the jet car. He offered to sponsor the underneath of it so he would get the exposure as it flipped upside down and went into the arm coast. I think he saw that coming, but wasn't too good.
Well, so you took some money off a New Zealand investor and just failed to put his sticker on, hoping he'd get away with it. Is that what happened?
Yeah, well, I actually had space for his sticker. This is true, but where the jet turbines produced all the heat, it tore the paint off the side of the jet car, so I had to put stainless strips down the side, which covered it, so I had to, in turn, send his money back home. And for me, you know, that's quite painful. You don't want to send a sponsor's money back.
He would have framed the money. He would have, contemplated long and hard about what to do next.
Yeah.
Hey, just want to talk about it. We've been spent a fair bit of time talking about the fact that in Formula One, if you're in front, that's pretty much where you stay. We don't see too much action, and that's why a lot of us here enjoy supercars a little bit more. But last week, fair to say, there was a little bit of action.
It was phenomenal. Actually, I don't actually watch too many races, and because it was a Canadian race, it was in a more civil time in Australia. It was a phenomenal race. It would have to have go down one of the best F1 races I've actually seen. The pressure that they were putting on there, some of the accidents that were going on. Lewis Hamilton, again, we spoke about it 2 weeks ago now from Monaco. He seemed he's literally just, driving the absolute neck off this car and actually taking so many risks. And, to have a side-by-side contact with your teammate down the front straight at Canadian, at the race, it was phenomenal. Now, there's probably a bit of blame on both sides in that instance, but he still turned Webber around at turn two or turn three. It was, certainly raised some eyebrows.
Yeah, it certainly did. I mean, normally the F1, you hear people come into work the next day and they sort of mention one incident and make a big deal of that, which really doesn't spark up a race that much. But it's hard to touch on everything that happened in that race, and the way that, the guy won it and drove through and got a penalty and all the bits and pieces was definitely quite impressive. And there is a lot to touch on that. But in other Australian motorsport as well, on the weekend, last weekend, the Fink Desert Rally went on just out of Alice Springs, and bit of a mishap.
Good place, Alice Springs.
Yeah, a good place that PD's going to spend 8 hours in on his trip to Darwin, which will be fun. Bit of a tough week for one of Australia's good speedway riders, Lee Adams, and a bit of a friend of mine from Mildura. Actually, he's hurt himself quite bad. He's in hospital from that. It was a tough race and a tough event in general, and you do see some injuries from that on a yearly basis. So our thoughts are out there with Lee and his family. But from the event itself, a guy that's won it before, I've actually done a little bit of fitness stuff with him, Ben Grabham, on his KTM, won it outright on the bikes. Now, at that event, it's a massive, massive long event, long endurance race. There was over 500 bikes entered that event to win that one. So it's massive, massive
event. And how many days? What do you know roughly how many kilometres the rally is?
It's I should know this. It's like 416 or 400 or 500 kilometres that you do throughout the day on the Sunday to win the event. So people go up there for over a week, or in some cases a fortnight, to try the track and do the testing. Yep. And being so long, it's hard. If someone does have a mishap, it takes a long time to get in there and get those guys. But you could imagine the pit area for 500 odd bikes, plus all the cars that are there as well. There's big off-road buggies, and I think Gartner and Jennings won it this year in a pretty impressive sort of car as well. A lot of guys are getting vehicles over from the state. So another done and dusted for another year, and again, a massive showing. We could actually 1 year probably to head up and have a look.
We know, Rico, that you're fairly keen. You jump into speedboat every now and then and go in some different events, Southern 80 that way. We know you ride the bike. Do you ever, thought about maybe getting involved in an event such as that?
I love my motorbike riding, to be honest. We grew up in Mildura and did a lot of riding on the farm, but that sort of riding is out of my league. And again,
we agree. We just wondering if you thought it.
Agree that it's out of my league, or that I grew up in Mildura.
No, we both.
Yeah, so I mean, definitely wouldn't consider that sort of thing. I love driving a car where there's a roll cage around you. It's not like PlayStation where you can turn the damage control on and go your hardest. And particularly when you race supercars, you can't turn up with a broken ankle or arm or leg when you've got to jump in the race car the next week. But certainly enjoy watching it.
Now, boys, we're into about our maybe 10th or 11th show of V8 Nation. You're doing a great job. We had Sam Newman in last week, starting to get the big high-profile guests. Now you're getting the big TVs brought into the studio, because make sure you check us out at on YouTube, at Croc Media TV as well, on Twitter. You get to see exclusive V8 Nation footage. But I rock up today, about the 40 intro, I reckon, the TCL sitting here, and I thought to myself, what is going on? what is going on? Then I realise, oh, of course, it's V8 Nation night. And that's exactly how it is now. So TCL, the nice big screen there with lots of motorsport on it. I'd like to thank you, boys, because before here, we were just getting the 15-inch black and white. Now you you come in, the high-profile guests, the TCL, so looking and working a treat.
We were just actually looking at how thin it is. It's pretty impressive, commenting on it just before we started. So if I were you, I'd be watching PD when he leaves tonight. I reckon it'll be under his arm.
Yeah, I don't think he's actually strong enough. But V8 Nation, if you'd like to follow us on Twitter, drop us an email if you want, v8nation@crocmedia.com.
This is V8 Nation with Rick Kelly and Paul Dumbrell.